Shuffle up and deal.
Well, this is it. We're here under the beautiful Fremont Street Experience in downtown Las Vegas. This is the finals of the 1997 World Series of Poker. We started out with over 4,000 players. We're down to 6 finalists. Interesting field. We have 3 professional poker players, 1 budding professional poker player who generally plays in $10 and $20 games right here at the Horseshoe. Now he's starting out with $5 and $10,000, and that's just to get in the pot, and there's no limit after that. We have the president of the Treasure Island, one of the major hotels here in Las Vegas, but leading the tournament at this point is Stu Unger. Now, Stu Unger won the title 1980, 1981, and he's reemerged. I would equate it to Jack Nicklaus in 1986 at the Masters. They hadn't heard those footsteps for a while, but when they started to hear them on the back nine, everybody started to get a little intimidated. If he accomplishes this, he will be only the second player to win 3 times. Right, Jim?
That's correct. Only the legendary Johnny Moss has taken 3 titles, 1970, 1971, and 1974. And of course, the fields were a lot smaller in those days.
Right. Stewie would have to come through 312 players just in the final event to win his 3rd title. All right, we're ready to begin. So good luck, everybody. This is it, the finals, 1997.
Binion's Horseshoe Casino on fabulous Fremont Street in downtown Las Vegas presents the 1997 World Series of Poker.
$2,000 ante, $5,000 and $10,000 blind. Shuffle up and deal.
The name of the game is Texas Hold'em. Other games come and go in popularity, but this is still the granddaddy of all poker games. These gentlemen will be starting with a $2,000 ante, a $5,000 and $10,000 blind. The gentleman who has the dealer button is theoretically dealing the hand, and all the action starts to the left of him with the $5,000 small blind and then the $10,000 big blind. It costs the other players $10,000 minimum to come into this hand. Most players will raise when they enter a pot, and then usually everyone else will go out. When 2 players enter a hand, then we have action. But everyone is usually a little tight in the beginning, so I don't think we'll see much action for a while, especially with Stewie having a small blind here. Bob throws his hand away. John Strempe is out. Mel Judah does not call the 10,000. Ron Stanley is the dealer. He has the button. He throws his hand away. Now Stewie's going to raise here. Pretty certain. Here he goes. 35,000. He makes it 35,000. And Peter, we might have action on this first hand. This could be incredible. Peter might call it. He has a decent hand, I think. He might call this. He's thinking about it very seriously. No, he decides not to, and we did not see our first flop.
Stu Unger wins the first pot. I think we're going to see a lot of this here today. Stu is not supposed to let very many hands go. As chip leader, and with his experience in the finals, I believe he's going to want to control the action.
When Stewie's in stroke, he's an excellent judge of character, an excellent judge of people, and that's what his strengths are. He reads the other players very well.
Gabe spoke with Stewie last night after he won a seat at the final table.
There's been a lot of big stories of this year's World Series of Poker. Record number of entrants, a lot of foreign winners, 12 out of 20 tournaments. A husband and wife team winning 3 tournaments. But I don't think there's any bigger story than the reemergence of Stu the Kid Unger, a gentleman who won back-to-back world championships in 1980 and 1981. He's not a kid anymore, but Stewie, congratulations.
Thank you, Gabe. I appreciate it.
Remember 1980 when you first, was that the first year you played in the tournament?
Yeah, it was the first time I ever played Norman Holm, in fact.
Remember you stormed through the field. I remember well because I was at the final table and you just cut through me like
yeah,
I wasn't.
But you got even with me 2 years later at the Tropicana when you flopped the biggest straight than me and you beat me for like $200,000 in the pot. I don't forget that.
You remember that biggest straight?
I will never forget it.
This guy probably doesn't know what he had for lunch, but he remembers that straight 15 years ago. How does it feel, Stewie, to be back on top, leading the World Series of Poker, going into the final day, bring back a lot of memories?
Oh, it's great, Gabe. It really is. You know, I haven't done well in this tournament since 81, and I really forgot how really great it is to be over here, be on TV, and everyone shaking hands, asking how you're doing. You know what I'm saying?
Your life's been like a roller coaster ride. You had some highs, some lows, and you had some personal tragedy in your life. It must feel really good to get back in there and be competing, be in front, final day, World Series of Poker. What's going to be your strategy tomorrow?
Well, I'm going to be a little more disciplined. I'm going to tell you my strategy right now is I'm going to try to have half the chips and get down the head up with someone else, with one other player, because I pretty much don't think anyone could beat me two-handed.
How much weight have you gained in the last 15 years?
I don't know how much I gained last year, but I'm lost about 6 pounds since this interview started with these lights. I have to eat 5 meals to make this up.
Stu the Kid Unger, back-to-back championships, 1980, 81. Can he do it 16 years later? We'll find out.
Welcome back to the 1997 World Series of Poker. Here, outdoors, under the fabulous Fremont Street Experience, our final six players are playing for a first prize of $1 million in cash. England's Mel Judah is up and bets $35,000.
Mel wins pot for $35,000.
Kind of unusual how you get into opening bets and that the people that open the pot usually open it for what's ever established as the opening bet. It seems to be $35,000. Has been established as the opening bet here, and that's what most people are opening for. John Stremp is contemplating calls. We have almost $100,000 in the pot right now.
Ace, Jack, 8, 2 clubs.
We have Ace, Jack, 8, 2 clubs. Interesting flop.
A lot of possibilities with that one.
A lot of possibilities.
John moves all in. Mel calls.
John's all in. All in against Mel Judah now.
Mel's got ace jack. John's got 7 jack. 9 of clubs.
John's got
club
7 9
draw
of clubs.
Against top two pair.
He needs a 10 or a club.
Or a 10.
As long as Mel Johnny's doesn't catch.
Club or a 10 for a straight.
An ace or a jack. That will just
jack.
Lock it up.
It's about a $400,000 pot. Okay.
In this pot right now.
Straight draw. Really
there's a club, he's got
club.
It.
John Stremp makes a
John
flush.
John Stremp takes the lead now. Mel Judah needs an ace or a jack to stay alive.
Final card's a 10. Club flush wins a hand. Just about 6.
Okay, Mel Judah had more chips than John, so he's still going to have some left. He's going to be in very bad shape.
That was really bad luck.
Mel Judah, our only foreign player to make the finals here. And he's in real danger of being the first one out.
Okay, we're here with former world champion Phil Hellmuth. Phil, you were sitting up here. Very interesting hand. John called the $25,000 raise with 7-9 of clubs and then flopped a flush draw and an inside straight draw. And he decided to move all in on the flop. It was a good move. It turned out to be a good move, but he might have played it a little cautious because if he lost, if Mel had anything, any ace, ace king, ace queen, he probably would have called, and John could have been eliminated from the tournament. But he was gambling. He's just moved all in again.
John Stremp's all in again.
Well, you know, this John Stremp's a very unconventional player because let me tell you something. When you call 25,000 more with a 7-9 of clubs, now Mel raised up front. He raised him.
Bob Walker is out.
He raised the first possible position there, okay? So when he came in raising the first possible position, you know he has probably a pretty big hand because he has five people to contend with behind him.
Must be nice to have a job.
Get it.
Play with no fear.
Bob's teasing John about how his high-paying position at the Treasure Island allows him to play with no fear. Well, have no fear. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the biggest outdoor poker game in history, the 1997 World Series of Poker.
I mean, to these guys, to all of us poker players, the professionals and even the amateurs alike, this is the holy grail of poker. This is the World Series of Poker. And if you win this, you're going to have your picture up on the wall forever. They're going to be writing magazine articles for at least 5 or 6 years about you, not to mention $1 million for first place.
Although today's $10,000 buy-in Texas Hold'em No Limit Finals will ultimately crown the world champion, it is by no means the only poker title won here at the World Series. Over the past few weeks, 21 championships were won in daily tournaments featuring games like 7-Card Stud, Draw, Raz, Omaha, even Chinese Poker. A record $12 million in prize money was awarded, all coming from the players themselves. To comprehend the size of this granddaddy of all poker tournaments, more prize money is awarded at the World Series of Poker than at the four major Grand Slam golf tournaments combined. Players from more than 30 countries come to the Horseshoe to test their skills against the best. This year, 12 of the 21 championships were won by foreign players, a record. Women won 3 open championships, another record. And the husband and wife team of Dr. Max and Maria Stern won 3 titles between them, a family feat that may never be duplicated. Here, world champions play alongside amateurs and club players, bringing together the greatest collection of poker playing talent in history. Now, back to the action.
Stu Unger is still our leader with about 1,030,000. Ron Stanley has about 850,000.
So far, Stewie's lost about 30,000.
I got about 700,000.
Ron is upped his
Bob Walker, 420,
stack about 150,000. So the gap has been closed significantly.
Two-time world champion Stu Unger has just called Ron Stanley's $40,000 raise. This could get interesting.
Stu called.
Look, this is very unusual.
We have a three-way pot.
The three biggest stacks. All
and Mel, this would be a real chance for Mel to make a lot of money here. If he has, he probably has something like 8, 9, 9, 10.
If he loses this pot, he'll have to call from long distance.
Mm-hmm. Probably thinking this would be a hell of a chance to quadruple my chips.
Yeah, that's true.
Three-way pot.
It's a hell of a chance to go broke too, because you know that Ron and Stu definitely have hands here.
Must be a fire nearby.
Here's a flop.
Flop comes ace, king, six offsuit.
Ace, king, six offsuit.
Check, check.
It's up to Stewie, first to have checked. Stewie
checks.
Seven. Two clubs.
Seven on a turn, two clubs. Six,
ace, king, six, seven of clubs. Somebody's gonna take some sort of a shot right here. John checks. Ron bets 45,000.
This could become our biggest pot yet, and an unusual situation, our three chip leaders bumping heads.
Stewie calls. 45,000. John folds.
John folds. We have the two big kahunas in here right now.
That's right. I would guess Stu has at least an ace, probably ace queen.
It's close to a $200,000 pot right now.
River cards are trad diamonds. Ace, king, 7-6 tray.
Ron checks.
Ron checks.
Stu probably has the best hand, but who knows?
Stu's got a tough decision here, but he moves right in.
Stu bets 100,000.
$100,000 raise. Ron looks like he's going to think about it. Players are drinking lots of water out here, but then it is the desert, and it is 90 degrees.
Very interesting situation. I would say that Stu definitely has.
You had a pickup. What would you say Stu has?
Stu has at least an ace and a queen. He might even have ace king for two pair, but I'd say he's ace queen or ace jack.
Ron's up against one of the best poker minds to ever play the game, and he's doing a lot of thinking. Last night, I caught up with him and asked him, just how are you going to play Stu?
From what I've seen of Stu Unger's play, he likes to play fast, aggressive. He moves his chips a lot. Are you just going to try to stay out of his way, or are you going to come over the top of him when you get at big pair, for example? Or what are your thoughts on that, or are you planning out your strategy later?
I'm just going to take my time. There's no need to get in a rush right now. There are a lot shorter stacks than me. I'm in pretty good shape, I think, and I think I got a good shot.
Ron said he was going to play it cool with Stewie. Let's see what he does.
I don't think Ron Stanley's going to call here.
You want to see this hand?
Ooh,
going to.
Ron Stanley calls 100,000. Stewie shows ace queen.
Ron went for it and got beat.
He's going to win the pot.
Ron's family probably had like ace-10 suited. I'm guessing ace-10 of diamonds or something like that.
Ron should have taken his own advice.
That was a big pot for Stewie's.
Big pot, now Stu Unger is, again, clearly the trip leader. Ron lost almost $200,000 in that pot.
Sure did.
Back in a minute. Welcome back to the World Series of Poker here outdoors in downtown Las Vegas.
I'll tell you what, I see this tournament as a battle for second place. That's what I see this tournament as.
Well, it's very magnanimous of you, Phil, to award the title to Stu Unger, but I think that the five other gentlemen might have something to say about that. They're not ready to give up at this point. Even though Stu has amassed over $1,250,000 right now, but if I can remember, you awarded yourself the title in Atlantic City, and you came in, what, was third or fourth?
Third. You got third.
Got a pot here between John Stremp and Stu Unger. About 80,000 in the pot right now. We have an ace, king of clubs, and a four of spades. They both check on the flop. Here's another spade, the eight of spades. We've got two clubs and two spades out there right now.
Stu's very good at looking at a player and knowing what he has. It's one of his strengths. I know because I personally bluffed off $200,000 to the guy this tournament. In fact, my bluffing him so many times kept him
Stu's call 45
in the tournament earlier.
There's two flush draws out there, and one of them comes. Actually, a straight flush out there. 5-7 of spades is a straight flush. Now, if John has a lone ace or something like that, he's going to check here. But he doesn't check. He bets. Looks like 70,000. John bet 70,000 and takes a puff.
It's awfully hot out here, even under the shade of this Fremont Street canopy. It just has to have some effect on the player's concentration.
Stewie, I think, is just trying to figure out whether or not to call. But who knows?
Stewie cuts off 70,000 and
called it. I think Stewie has like an ace jack.
John shows king, ten of spades for a spade flush.
Well, I saw Stewie flash an ace.
Stu had the aces?
So actually, Stewie had the best hand all the way until the river. John needed a spade, a king, or a 10. But particularly a spade was just a beautiful card for him.
15-minute break.
You want Stewie?
Hey, Stewie, come over here a minute. Stewie!
Why'd you call John Shrimp with that aces?
I knew he didn't have an ace. You know, I just knew he didn't have ace every time he flops top pair. I don't want to say it. He's probably be listening.
Well,
he moves in all his chips every time he flops top pair. He don't even give you a chance to bet at it.
I mean,
every time he makes top pair, he just moves all his money in. You know, I knew he didn't have an ace. If he backdoor spades, I can't help it. I almost raised him at the end, figuring he might have made some two golf on go two pair with three spades up there and look at it and ran into it.
My point is that he's not going to bluff 70,000 at the end.
This guy's a better king, thinking it's the best hand. You know, I don't know what the guy's capable.
What do you know about poker?
The president of hotel. He's the stick. You know.
Yeah, take a walk. Go back to New York.
Listen, Phil. He's sitting right there with me. He knows what he's talking about.
It's worth going back and taking a look at that hand based on what Stu Unger said, because he was confused by John Stremp's action. John Stremp raised on 4th Street, 45,000, with a pair of kings and a flush draw. And this confused Stewie because he didn't think John Stremp was capable of doing that. It's almost like the Cincinnati Kid where the man raised on the come trying to make a flush, and it confused Steve McQueen. Stewie Unger, who's our kid, who's our Brooklyn kid actually, was confused by John Stremp's action, and it almost caused him to make a big mistake. So when the flush comes on the end and John Stremp bets a little 70,000, like he's got not too big a hand, Stewie was confused and almost raised. But being a great player, not a good player, he contemplated the pros and cons and decided the right course of action was just to call.
Even in losing, Stewie manages a small victory. Welcome back to the World Series of Poker. I'm Jim Albrecht. With me is Gabe Kaplan, 1989 world champion, Bill Helman.
These guys are looking at a World Series championship. immortality in poker.
Here's our most interesting situation.
Just beautiful.
Ron Stanley in the small blind, 5,000. Stu Unger in the big blind, 10,000.
Stewie has nice position on Ron. Stewie has more chips and he's behind Ron. That means that Ron has to act.
Ron just calls the 5,000.
Ron has to act, let's see.
Small pot between
Stewie
and
lets
Ron.
It go, 10,000 each.
Five out of six pots, Ron has to act first. So Stewie has advantage to sit back and
spades.
Wait and see what he does.
Ace 9-6 with two spades. Both check. An eight making a straight possible. It's two straights possible. 5-7 or a 7-10. Ron bets 25,000. Stewie's gonna call.
I don't know.
You don't think so?
Look at
he's
this.
He's not only calling, he's raising.
Stu raises
60,000.
Ace 9-8-6, two spades.
If I had to guess at this point, I would say that Stewie has two pair lines up. What hand you put Stewie on, Phil?
Well, you know, it's just hard to say. Stewie may have a 9-10 here. I mean, which is a pretty good hand. Two nines and
he
a straight draw.
He might have a 9-10, right?
It's highly unlikely that he has a straight, but if he does have a straight,
yeah, he might have a straight. 60,000 was a bet that he would make if he had a straight. Trying to trap, trying to get as much money as possible, but not wanting to overload.
Ron calls 60,000.
All right, I think he's called.
Final card's a king.
Next card's a king,
which
is
9-8-6.
That didn't change much.
Visible support.
I guess Ron checked, and Stewie's thinking about betting 200,000.
Looks like he's going to bet 200,000. He makes it 220,000.
Stu bets 220,000.
220,000.
I'll tell you this much. I'm beginning to really love Stu's hand here. Doesn't look like a 9-10 anymore.
Yeah, and I don't think he's got two pair anymore. Having played with Stewie over the years, I would say that Stewie's either got a straight or he was drawing to a straight. In other words, he's got the 5-7 or the 7-9, or he's got a 10-jack or a 10-queen. I would put him on one of those four hands.
This is a major, major bet for this time of the tournament.
Oh, yes. I mean, he just bet on the river. He just bet on the last card here more than, I mean, let me see. I can't see Bob's. He bet more than two out of the six players have left in front of him. If Ron Stanley were to call and lose his pot, Stu would just have an absolutely huge chip lead.
I would have to say that I think Stewie has a very strong hand.
Oh, yeah.
But that 60,000 raise was just to try and make sure Ron called. Hoping Ron had some sort of a hand.
Absolutely. I think Stu probably does have.
Now, we'd both be surprised if Ron raised, wouldn't we?
Yeah, wait.
Ron laid it down. Stu showed a bluff. Stu showed a bluff.
Queen 10 offsuit. Stu bluffed him.
Ron folds. Stu was bluffing with a queen 10. Ron had two nines.
What was very interesting about that hand, Phil, was that Stewie played that hand exactly like he would have played it if he had a straight or if he had nines and eights, because he raised 60,000 on 4th Street, which
very
was
true.
Not an overwhelming raise, but the kind of raise he would make if he had a big hand, and then he would have followed up with a major bet on the end, 220,000. So he played it like he had a real big hand, and Ron suspected something, but he couldn't call with the two nines.
You know, that was a very interesting hand, and I mean, had he made that call, who knows how it would affect Stu.
Hi, I'm Drew Carey, and I'm getting royally flushed here at the World Series of Poker at the Horseshoe in Las Vegas, Nevada.
The Fremont Street Experience in downtown Las Vegas is the centerpiece of America's gambling mall. Each night, more than 20,000 visitors are dazzled by a spectacular light and sound show featuring more than 2 million lights and a 500,000 watts of concert quality sound. What a show.
That's right, Binion's Fabulous Horseshoe, where we are here. And you knew Benny Binion, the original Binion, so to speak.
I knew him, and I knew his son. Now I know his son. This is
Jack Binion.
And this is the most fabulous place I've ever seen.
This is the Fremont Street Light Show right here.
It's fabulous because with all the bulbs, I don't know how much the bulbs cost, but there's a lot of electricity. I wouldn't like to pay the bill here.
You know why I think you really love it, Milton?
Why?
Because you got lucky on the 21 table right in here. That's what
Quiet, my wife is standing here.
Oh, my God. Lorna, that was scripted. It's just a joke.
Welcome back to the World Series of Poker. It's amazing that after several hours of no-limit play, all six players are still with us. I'm Tournament Director Jim Albert, here with Gabe Campbell.
Stu the Kid Unger still has all the chips, and Bob Walker now has the call, 10,000, he goes out. John Strem thinks about it, he goes out. Mel Judah is going to make a substantial raise here. Looks like 70,000. For 70,000 now, that's the price of poker. Ron Stanley says no, too steep. Stewie's out. Peter, I don't think he has 70,000. He has about 50,000 more. He looks serious about. There he goes. He's going all in.
He really had no choice here. He's almost down to the felt.
64,000. Peter's dead to a jack. Peter needs a jack or some sort of straight involving a jack.
Or he's going to go home with sixth place and 127,000.
Bob comes 6, 7, 9, six of spades.
Still needs a jack. Still needs a jack. He's got no hearts. Needs a jack.
Cards are three at time.
Still needs a jack. He's got one card. He's got three cards in the deck to win with. Three jacks. There's the last card.
Final cards of five.
Doesn't get it.
Now Judah wins in hand. Peter Bowles.
Finishing sixth out of 312 of the world's best. Isn't bad.
Peter wins 127,000.
Peter Bao becomes our sixth place finisher, $127,200. Not a bad payday.
Mel's been on a roller coaster here, but he's having a lot of fun.
We're here with Peter Bao, who just came in sixth in the World Series of Poker final event. He took home $127,000. How do you feel right now?
I feel satisfied about it. You know, I was hoping to come in fifth place, but you know. And now I came with this play, which is just all right to me.
Now, you generally play in small games here at the Horseshoe, 10 and 20, 20 and 40. What was it like playing for $10,000 and $20,000 a hand?
It's kind of nervous, you know, big money. It's big different. It's more exciting.
Do you think you played well?
Oh, yeah, I think I played very well. I had a lot of patience.
And the others that I mentioned earlier?
Patience is an important part of poker, isn't it?
Yeah, and reading the player, too.
Now we're down to five. Stay tuned. The action's heating up. Welcome back to the World Series Poker Finals on Fremont Street in downtown Las Vegas. The misters are cooling it down a bit, but the action is still hot.
Okay, we're here with two-time defending women's champion Susie Isaacs, who won in 1996. She's won again this year, the only repeat champion. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
I know you have a big rooting interest in this tournament. Your coach is one of the finalists.
That's correct, Ronnie Stanley.
And he taught you a lot about poker.
He certainly did.
Are you more nervous when you play at the final table, as you've done these last 2 years in a row, or are you more nervous watching your coach play?
I'm more nervous watching somebody I truly care about play.
Well, Ron might be a little nervous himself, up against Stu Unger with a mountain of chips.
Keep in mind also that Stewie has a reputation for being able to read these players almost clairvoyance.
Well, from a clairvoyant right now, we're going to a president of a hotel who's not only calling your coach's $60,000 raise, he's going all in, raising about $145,000, $150,000. There's about $200,000 out there, puts John Strempe all in. Mel Judah looks like he's thinking about it, throws his hand away. And Ron Stanley is going all in. Stu Unger is still in his spot, not anymore. Stewie's out. It's a hand between Ron Stanley and John Stremp. Ron Stanley turns over two kings, and John Stremp has two tens. Big favorite, about a 5-to-1 favorite. And Mel Judah's telling everybody that he had a 10. There's only one card in the deck that he could win with, that John Stremp could win with. There's the flop 3-6-7. They both have a club. John Stremp could tie if a 4 and a 5 came out, giving them both a straight, but there's he's like a 22-to-1
10 ball
dog here. There's the 10. That is unbelievable. That's 22-to-1. The last 10 in the deck has just come up and put John Stremp in the lead. And the last card doesn't do anybody any good. John Stremp has caught lightning in a bottle. He has caught the case 10.
Yeah,
and you are looking at one very unhappy gentleman,
Two tens. Hit the
Mr. Ron
ten.
Stanley, who felt good when he saw the kings over the tens. He felt absolutely terrific when Mel Judah said that he had a 10. And
sick.
Now he feels just about as bad as you can feel. I really empathize with him. This is a terrible situation. And his face reflects everything that's happened right now.
He hit the one card in the deck, a 10.
Mel still can't believe the case 10 came on the turn.
And that is what they call, in poker, a bad beat. About the worst that it could be.
That's as bad as it gets.
Ron Stanley also has a reputation as being a tremendous short stack player. And so am I, because he taught me.
Okay, we're here with Linda Johnson, who's the owner and publisher of Card Player Magazine, a magazine that deals mostly with poker. Linda, I know you've been at a lot of final tables. You, in fact, won a tournament this year, the Raz Tournament. Congratulations.
Thanks. It was very exciting. It was my dream as a poker player to win, and I'm very thrilled.
Were you aware in that hand where John Shrimp had two tens and Ron Stanley had two kings that Mel Judah said that he had a 10?
No, I didn't know he'd said that, so that just makes it all the worse.
Little 44-to-1 shot just came right out there.
Right. I'm very impressed with the caliber of play. It seems like every year I watch it, it gets better and better. I know a lot of that is the fact that they're playing longer, they're playing against more opponents, and they're able to review the tapes from prior years. There's a lot of books being written, and it just continues to improve every year.
Bob's all in. Let's see if John calls. No.
How much is that, Bob?
8.
Looks like Mel's going after him. This could be it for Bob Walker.
Fair deuces.
I don't even know what I have.
Queen ten of spades against two deuces.
Put my duck out there.
Let's see some big ones.
Quick duck.
And here's the flop. Jack 9-6 off suit.
Bob has got an open end straight. He could win with an 8, a 10, a queen, or a king. 8, 10, queen, king.
The flop helped him a lot.
No. Still needs an 8, 10, queen, or king.
Mel's two ducks are still flying high.
8, 10, queen, king. Here's the last card. 8, 10, queen, king.
Bob is gone.
Nope.
That's it. Okay, so Bob Walker's our fifth place finisher. Collects $161,000.
Bob takes a drink of his Coke and says, "Where am I? What just happened? Is it really over?"
Welcome back. This is Richard Mall at the World Series of Poker. I'm still alive. I have no money, but I'm still alive.
Welcome back to the World Series of Poker here in downtown Las Vegas. It's still a scorcher, and the wind's kicking up.
Okay, we're talking to Bob Walker, who just came in fifth in the World Series of Poker. Bob, how about the experience? I know we were talking a little bit before, and you just told me you didn't think you mixed it up enough.
Well, the experience was very enjoyable, very interesting. Binion's always puts on a first-rate show and first-rate tournament. And
well, congratulations, fifth place is a hell of a finish. What'd you pick up? $161,000, not bad for 4 days' work. Four players are left now. Mel Judah throws his hand away. It's up to Mr. Ron Stanley, who is going to make a little race here. He makes it $60,000 to play. Duonger throws his hand away. It's up to Mr. Schrempf, president of Treasure Island. He's going to call. It looks like he may raise. He just calls the 60,000. Mel Judah throws his hand away. So once again, like we've had in the past, John and Ron are locking horns. 140,000 in the center.
Here's a flop.
Flop comes king of clubs, seven of clubs, deuce of diamonds.
King, seven of clubs, and a deuce of diamonds. And as he's done so many times, John leads out.
Has no fear.
Now this time, I think, Jim, I think Ron's going to play this hand.
I think he is. But right at about this moment, I wish he put something on his cards.
Yeah, it is very windy here, and it would be a disaster if we're playing for $1 million here to have one of his cards blow over right now.
They're changing dealers, so you probably
Ron's going to raise. Ron's going all in. He just said he's going all in. Let's see what John Schrempf does. He doesn't take any time at all. He calls. I think John Schrempf has a hell of a hand here. I have no idea what Ron has.
Okay, Ron's all in now.
John's looking at Ron. What's your hand, buddy?
Turn up, guys.
John's John turned over two aces. He's got aces in the pocket. John Stanley has got a jack eight nothing. He was bluffing. He is zigging and zagging at the wrong time today. A bluff into two aces.
John Strimp's going to win the hand.
What a time to bluff.
Ace of the river for aces full. Ron Stanley is our fourth place finisher.
So that style that John Strimp used all through the tournament led Ron
to believe he was weak.
To believe he was weak.
To believe he might have had.
He was going to pick up this pot, and unfortunately, he ran into the two aces.
He just called with the aces before the flop, and when that very good flop for him came up, hoping probably that Ron had a pair of kings, you know, a king queen or something.
Exactly.
King jack.
And moving very fast, as he had done in the past when he was weak.
Right. Well, we're now down to three players. Mel Judah is going to open this pot for $60,000. It's up to Stu the Kid Unger, who really isn't a kid anymore, but he's still maybe the best poker player in the world. He calls the 60,000. John Strimp is out, and we have a pot between Mel Judah and Stu Unger.
$146,000 pot.
Here's the flop. 10 jack, 3, 2 hearts. That piece of glass, incidentally, comes from my mother's condominium in Florida. She was kind enough to let us use it. Check, check on the flop. Here's 4th Street, deuce of clubs. Let's see what happens here. Stu's not going to let this go any further. Here he goes. He's betting $80,000.
Stu bets $80,000. Mel moves all in.
Mel Judah doesn't take a lot of time. He calls and raises, goes all in.
Looks like about 200.
Happened so fast, Stewie doesn't know what happened. He says, count it, and he stares at Mel Judah trying to get some kind of read. What do you have, Mel? Do you have a drawing hand? You could have a queen king and just raise, hoping to buy the pot 30. Right here. That's what Stewie's trying to figure out. But Mel Judah is sitting there like Mel Buddha, not trying to give anything away.
$162,000.
Stu's trying to figure it out. It's real tough. Both checked on the flop. And now Mel Judah goes all in, and Stewie says, looks to me like Stewie's got a jack with maybe a mediocre kicker, like a jack eight. He's trying to figure out if the hand is good. He usually makes the right decisions in these circumstances. Let's see if he makes the right one here.
He calls. Turn them up, guys.
Turns over jack with a good kicker, jack queen.
Mel
Judah has a 9-10. Mel Judah is in very bad shape in this spot. He needs a 9 or a 10 to win. Otherwise, he's going to be our third place finisher.
One card to come.
Mel Judah knows he's not in good shape. Here's the last card.
The cards are king. Stu Unger wins the hand. King. Mel Judah becomes our third place.
Mel Judah's out of the tournament. Stu Unger has knocked Mel Judah out. It's very kind of interesting circumstances there. It seemed to me like Mel Judah might have thought that Stu Unger was drawing and didn't want him to draw. He might have thought that a pair of tens were the best hand. It's a question of Stu Unger confusing Mel Judah, I think, and Mel Judah being so confused that he confused Stu Unger. In any case, Mel Judah is going to take home a sizable paycheck for coming in third. And speaking about cash, in typical Binion style, here comes $1 million in a cardboard chiffon box.
what is your fund? Toilet paper? So this is typical. We got $1 million in cash in a toilet paper box here. There's $1 million in cash, an actual $1 million in United States currency on the table, along with the gold bracelet that signifies you're the world champion of poker. And now the players have the added pressure of having to look at that $1 million.
This is like a Western movie. Who's going to be the hero?
With that $1 million on the table, I think if you put a cowboy hat on John, he'd look a little bit like Clint Eastwood.
Which cowboy is going to ride into the sunset with $1 million grubstake?
For those of you who said, I'll never see $1 million in my lifetime, well, you're seeing it. You're looking at it. $1 million right on the table.
This is it. Heads up poker for hard cash between Stu the Kid Unger and John, treasure of the Sierra Madre Strimp.
So he's going to raise 40,000. Goes 40,000 for John to call. John calls, 40,000 raise. Got $124,000 in the center right now. Here's a flop. Ace 3-5, different suits. John's first act, and here he goes again.
Right away.
Betting out. 120,000. Now at this point, Stewie's well aware that the last time John bet out, he had a pair of aces in the pocket. And that's one of the things that's going through Stewie's mind. A feeling, exactly, does John have something? Does he have a marginal hand like he's bet with so many times before, or does he have a real good hand like the last time he bet out on the flop?
So he keeps looking back at that one card as if he's got a, maybe got an ace, but doesn't like what it, the other is kicker.
Every so often, Stewie will glance up and try and catch.
He's going to call.
I raise it.
Raises.
This could be it, ladies and gentlemen. He's rating $800,000.
And he does have
John calls. Here we go. This could be it.
Ace four. Ace with no kicker.
He needs a deuce or a four. He needs a, Stewie needs a deuce or a four.
Stu's in a little bit of trouble here. A tray won't do it. Yes.
Deuce. Stewie wins the tournament. Stu Unger has won 3 World Series of Poker.
Incredible.
Well, it was a complete reversal of fortune. Stu Unger had played great, intimidated everybody all day, but to win his 3rd title, he had to get lucky at the end. John Shrimp, who played well all day, but got real lucky to win a few hands. Now, in the hand that counted the most, he got real unlucky. Looking at a picture of a very happy 14-year-old girl. This is Stu Unger's daughter, Stephanie, and I know that you played very hard today, and one of the reasons was for this little girl. I haven't seen her for about 7-8 years, but she's a very beautiful young lady.
Well, I appreciate that, Gabe. Thank you. I called up last night, and she says to me, Daddy, I'm going to disown you if I don't win the tournament. And I said, Stephanie, I love you too much for you to disown me. I said, I'm going to win the tournament. And it's where you'll go on loving me. I guaranteed a victory, and I proved myself worthy of it.
Stu, let me ask you a personal question. I think I know you well enough to ask you this question.
You did, sir.
In 1980 and 1981, you won the championship, but you weren't smart after that. Your life didn't go 100% in the right course. Now you're older, you're wiser, you're 43 years old. You think you're going to do things differently now?
Well, I hope so, Gabe. You know, I've neglected my kid. You know, I've done a lot of stupid things myself. But I want to tell you something for a fact. There's nobody that ever beat me playing cards. The only one that ever beat me was myself, my bad habits. But when I get to playing like I was on stroke this tournament, I really believe that no one can play with me on a daily basis.
Stu the Kid Unger is back, and look out next year. Congratulations.
Thank you, Gabe. I appreciate everything. And I want my daughter's picture one more time. I love you, honey, and I'll be seeing you soon.
Can I get that $300 you borrowed from me about 6 years ago?
a kicker. My God, I see. That's, there's no justice.
But it was worth it.
So, where was that buffet bar?